Bonjour tout le monde, merci beaucoup pour la chance de parler avec nous aujourd'hui. C'est un moment vraiment joyeux pour moi. And pardon le français de oiseau. I'd never get to practice anymore, and I'm very sorry. I have tried in the past. I'll work harder in the future now that we can travel a bit more. As is mentioned, I've been working on a project with the Ontario Special Investigations Unit. It's funded by SHRC through the Partnership Development Scheme. I should be very clear that the SIU would like you to know that it is a arm's length partnership. They do not have direction in terms of the intellectual progression of the project, but we do work together on one specific element of the project, and that's on conducting a process called the race-based data analysis that's been mandated for all public service institutions or organizations in Ontario. So if I sort of go through here, what I thought I would do today, unfortunately, the data for our project are still embargoed at this moment. They actually went to the director of the SIU just last week. So we're hoping for approval to share them publicly shortly. They are going to have to go to the Ontario government first. But I'll sort of go through the process a bit more of how this data were collected and some of the problems that we have with the data in terms of how we're going to interpret it and make sense of it. And maybe some comment on the validity of the exercise and the value of the exercise as a consequence. But I thought I'd go over today exactly how we ended up in this place, how this built out of the Police Involved Shootings Project. I thought I'd cover, because Ontarians, as you know, are living, and Torontonians in particular, are at the center of the known universe. So we often assume that everyone else knows exactly what's going on in Ontario. I will not make that mistake. I'll explain a little bit about the legislation and how this data standards have come about, and then I'll talk about this issue that we've come across of disproportionality versus discrimination in a police, civilian police oversight body. So, leading into this project, Carmen, our postdoctoral fellow, and I had been working for 4 years, a little bit over 4 years, on a series of case study analyses of police-involved shooting incidents that were prosecuted at the criminal level, where video evidence played a key role in those prosecutions. And these were, we had 8 case studies that we took an interest in. At the time of application to SHRC for this funding, we had 100% of the population, so we knew exactly what was going on. By the time we actually got the funding and everything started rolling, there'd been a significant number of new prosecutions that we were made aware of, prosecutions that had been sort of emerging. So this isn't meant to be by any means a, excuse me, a representative sample or anything. It's just an interest sample that we got. And we became very interested in this legal fictional character, the reasonable officer, who's referred to in all of these cases. This is a legal standard. It stems out of the Anglo-American common law tradition of the reasonable man or the reasonable person. But the police officer in our societies is understood to be such a unique character and have such a unique perspective on the world that there's an additional level of jurisprudence, an additional level of understanding that's applied at the legal level to understand what comprises or what produces a reasonable officer. And juries are instructed on this, that when they are investigating or evaluating police conduct, they should do it from the perspective of a reasonable officer. So we are very interested in this reasonable officer. And through the process of this research, we also became aware through the Ontario Special Investigations Unit, who is responsible for conducting the criminal investigations into police officers for use of force incidents, sexual assault allegations, and traffic collisions, that roughly, it used to be 93% of these cases were resolved without criminal charge. In other words, the SIU decided that the officer had acted reasonably outside of a court setting, and there was no need for further process or public review of the officer's conduct. That number's increased since 2020, 2021, now to 97% of police officers who are investigated in these types of cases being exonerated without criminal proceeding. So the charges are not recommended to the Crown Attorney. So the SIU is sort of a gateway to understanding who the reasonable officer is and what it is that produces reasonable police conduct. And we were very interested in this because from our outsider perspective, we kind of thought this institution seemed a little bit opaque, and the public sort of understanding of what the SIU was not where we thought it ought to be. I mean, who are we to judge on such things? But that was sort of the impression that we got. And we are also interested in, through this, how the sort of formulation of the reasonable officer would differ between the two contrasting groups that are investigated by the SIU. That is the police officers themselves, they're referred to as subject officers in these cases, and a subject officer would be an investigated party, an accused, as well as what the SIU calls affected persons. And affected persons, generally speaking, at least in our data or the data that we're interested in, would be people who were victims of police violence, people who had been assaulted by the police to the degree that it caused serious injury, requiring hospitalization, or the survivors of people who had been killed by the police. So the Ontario SIU, I actually got a slight reprimand from them because I called them a quasi law enforcement agency. They are a law enforcement agency. They made sure that I was very aware of that in my report writing to them. They have powers of arrest and they do carry handcuffs. I did not know that. But they are not armed, or at least as far as I understand, they're not typically armed. And they will conduct investigations into every circumstance where police interact with an individual that results in a hospitalization and serious injury. Serious injury is usually the threshold of something like a broken bone or a concussion or something along those lines, and it goes right up the threshold to severe tissue damage and head injuries, severed limbs. The list goes on. They will investigate every death where a police officer is involved, and there are some very interesting conceptualizations of how a police officer is involved in death that the SIU investigates. The officer themselves does not necessarily need to be the cause of death. They can simply be present while somebody who is, say, being transported to hospital in an ambulance for a drug overdose or something along those lines. If an officer is present for that, then the SIU will investigate that incident. They also investigate sexual assault allegations. The public in Ontario tend to conflate the SIU with the police, that they are just another police agency, and there are some reasonable grounds for that. The SIU does have a tendency to recruit their investigators from police ranks. It's my understanding from some of the SIU investigators or their contract employees that I've spoken with in a casual basis that they really like getting road sergeants from the police ranks, that they have familiarity with traffic collisions that's very valuable to SIU investigations. But we've also seen all kinds of other characters, investigators from the labor board. We've seen some people who were paramedics and ambulance drivers who became SIU investigators in their post-ambulance driving careers. I believe that there's at least one teacher that we've been told about, a former teacher who became an SIU investigator. The SIU director is the most important figure in the SIU, not just because they control the financial flow and management of the organization, but they also have the exclusive discretion to decide whether or not charges will be pressed based on the data, the evidence that's put for them by their investigators. So any charge decision that comes from the SIU will implement the charge through the director, and that charge is then an evidence package is passed on to the Crown Attorney's office, and the Crown Attorney picks up the ball and runs from it. There's some interesting stuff to look at there in terms of what the Crown Attorney's office does with it, but I'm gonna set that aside for today. So we were interested again in this issue of what a reasonable officer is and how the concept of a reasonable officer might be contrasted between people who had been investigated as subject officers by the SIU, but also people who had been victims of police violence. And so we approached the SIU through some contacts and said, you know, this is what we're really interested in, and we are at sort of an inflection point here. We're still reeling from the murder of George Floyd. We've seen recently the incident in Memphis that's caused quite a bit of public concern. We thought that this was really a moment to turn the spotlight onto civilian police oversight and try at least whatever we can do to instill more confidence in the institution of civilian police oversight, if not policing itself. And the SIU was pretty sort of piqued by the idea. I think they've been very cooperative in a number of ways, but they were especially interested in this exercise that they'd been assigned to do by the Ontario government, their analysis of their race-based data. So they had been collecting survey data about these two distinct groups, the affected persons on one side and the subject officials on the other side, about their race-based characteristics. And they had been ordered by the provincial government through legislation to start analyzing this data. Now, If you ask someone like me, the SIU is a very small institution. They have an annual budget of about $9 million. They employ roughly 45 investigators, plus their secondary staff. So there's not a lot of leeway and not a lot of expertise built into the institution. So they said, you know what, you're interested in this reasonable officer person. That sounds really great. Do you want to do our race-based data analysis for us in a quid pro quo? And we thought, oh, you know, well, that's interesting because race and policing is, of course, one of the central issues that brings us all into this area. That's great. Yeah, let's do it. We'll hire a statistician. This sounds like a lot of fun. I went through and I read and I'm like, oh, actually, I'm not a statistician, but these stats look easy and fun. All right, let's do this. So they've been very sort of forthcoming with providing information about race-based data, and we're sort of trying to nudge them into a relationship where maybe we get to speak a bit more to people who have been investigated to fill out this data a little bit. I'll talk about why that's important as we go on. But first, let's talk about this legislation. This comes through the Anti-Racism Act of 2017, which was passed by the previous Liberal government. I think there's probably fair to say that there'll be some in Ontario who are surprised, and I would probably count myself among them, that this legislation survived the change in government, but it has. It stayed in place, and in 2018, through an order in council, every public service organization in Ontario has been ordered to start collecting this data. So this is just some notes from the preamble that the government included with the act itself, which is to say that the government acknowledges that there is systemic racism in Ontario, that it is an interest of the government and the province itself to advance racial equality. It's really interesting framing. I don't believe the wording has actually changed since the new government has come to power, but it's based very much on economic interests, that it is in everyone's economic interests that newcomers to Ontario, that racial minorities in Ontario be able to participate fully in the society and pull in the economy, that there is a push to make sure that there's economic development out of this, which is something that I thought was important to flag, that there's more than just social justice outcomes involved here. There's also the financial well-being of people in the province that's being considered. Make of that what you will. So we get this final line here, eliminating systemic racism supports social, economic, and cultural development as a whole. I'll take their word for it. Sounds like a good idea to me for all kinds of different reasons. So we go on here to define some of the public service organizations, and this is again sort of nicked right from the legislation itself. The thing that I would note is that policing services are right at the top of the government's ladder of the organizations that ought to be doing this type of work. The other part types of areas that we should look at are the courts, of course, although they're mentioned through the bail process, education and healthcare. This really became quite the issue during the pandemic when doctors were anecdotally reporting racial disparities when it came to people presenting with COVID-19. As you know, Canada's been very reluctant to gather race-based data in the past, which is a contrast to the United States or Europeans. And there's been the push now more recently to start collecting this type of data so we can have this evidence-based discussion. Child and family services, of course, being the other sorts of areas that we might look at. And these are roughly the divisions in the government that would be concerned with this. The Act allows, or the order in council allows for two types of data collection. Everyone is mandated to do direct data collection, which they describe as self-report survey. So every organization, every public service and organization in Ontario has to run a survey with their users and offer their users the opportunity to participate in the survey at some point so that they can self-identify as the race. Typically are covering gender categories. The SIU gathered religious information. They also covered some other demographic information, like the age of the respondents. In the SIU's case, they gathered data on what the investigation type was, whether or not it was a firearm discharge or a use of force incident resulting in injury, a sexual assault allegation, and so forth. The other methodology that's permitted through the order in council is what they call indirect data collection, which would be more like the service provider's report of the impression of race-based data. So the impression that the individual that they're interacting with gives. Now, the element of that data that I find kind of interesting is the government has very tightly restricted when you are permitted as a public service organization to collect that type of data. What they have stipulated is that in order to collect indirect data, you must have an autonomous and unique interaction that has an outcome with that individual. So in the case of the police and police services across Ontario, they've been collecting this type of information through standard use of force reporting. And my understanding of the standard use of force reporting is it is officer impression of the race of the person that they're interacting with. They've also done this through strip search data. And the reason why the police services have been permitted to use that type of data gathering approach is because use of force is a unique and an autonomous interaction between the officer and the member of the public. So they're making the judgment on race themselves, and it's not going to anyone else outside the interaction. And that does complicate things for data gathering at the SIU. But from my perspective and the advice that we're giving to the SIU, I would suggest that the indirect data is actually the more robust data and the data that we should be gathering in place of the self-report survey data. And we'll sort of come to, again, I'm sort of holding a few things in abeyance here until we get a bit through the process as it's sort of gone through. All right, these are not SIU investigators. At least I don't think they are. But it was a nice looking picture, and it sort of reminded me of X-Files, which was my favorite show as a kid, so I thought I'd throw it in here. How does the SIU work? Normally, what will happen is a police service will report to the SIU that there's been a hospitalization or a death in result of interaction. And I'm just going to sort of limit it to that at this point. I won't talk about the sexual assault allegations or vehicle collisions. So officers have attended some incident where somebody's been injured or somebody's been hurt requiring hospitalization. And the SIU will typically dispatch a number of investigators, depending on where the location is. But if it's in southwestern Ontario or central Ontario, where the population is relatively dense, they'll go to the hospital and they will interact with the affected person in the hospital. They'll start their investigation there. There's obviously different parameters around death cases, although we have had cases where the survivors of people killed by police, their next of kin, will be in the hospital and the SIU will be there to inform them of the news of their loved one being deceased. And it can be the case that the SIU is the one delivering that news to the survivor of the decedent. At the conclusion of this interview, one of the investigators, we've seen teams as small as two and as large as, I think, 4 to 6. Sometimes when you include the forensic investigators, the teams get a little bit larger. But I think generally what we've heard is that they'll have 3 investigators conducting one of these investigations. And at the conclusion of the interview with the affected person, they'll say, would you be interested in participating in our race-based data collection exercise? I'll sort of keep a lid on the response rates, but I would say that the response rates among affected persons were respectable. That at least a significant proportion of the people who were affected persons were willing to participate and give their data over to the SIU. At certain circumstances, the SIU investigator would deem that it was inappropriate to gather data at that point. You can imagine that a lot of these people are in quite a bit of distress. So as a backup, the SIU could contact them by phone and conduct the investigation over the phone, or they might arrange to meet in person. They have been sort of experimenting with other means. They would mail out surveys to especially subject officers with their final report. That final report would go to the employing police service, and then it would be the obligation of the police service to hand the paper survey with a self-addressed stamped envelope to the subject official, which would then be mailed back to the SIU. You can see some of the data collection issues that emerged here. Or at least the grounds by which some of these data collection issues would emerge. So it's been a bit of a piecemeal process. They've been looking to digitize it, but one of the key issues of the Act itself is privacy concerns. And there's been a fair bit of back and forth between the SIU and the government about and the privacy commissioner to protect those privacy issues and make sure we're not identifying people who have participated in the race-based data collection exercise, presumably on the auspice that if people, say a subject official, were able to deduce that an affected person had been cooperating with the SIU or give the impression that they might seek reprisal or something along those lines. So in this data collection exercise, the government of Ontario has actually established 8 race-based categories of which you might belong. There is also another category which you can select, and at that point you might be prompted to identify what race-based category that you are. But it's a bit of an interesting categorization. It doesn't match census categorization. So when we were doing our analyses, we had to do a little bit of gerrymandering, and for a non-statistician, this was a fun exercise. I got to admit, I really enjoyed it. It was actually a real nice departure from my workaday world of ethnomethodology and conversation analysis. So I had a little bit of fun. Maybe I'll do a little bit more of this. Generally speaking, what we would do is we would take the national categories from the census data, and we would convert those into the race-based categories that the Ontario government had mandated. It's obviously not a perfect alignment, but we did what we could with the information we got. This graph is also fake, so there's nothing implied by it except to say that there were two distinct patterns that emerged through this data, especially at the response level. Like I said, affected persons, if you were conducting this as sort of a social science survey and mailing out surveys, you'd be very pleased with the response rate. It exceeds what's taught in the textbooks by a factor of at least two. Subject officials, on the other hand, and subject officials are called such because they can be police officers, but they can also be the Parliamentary Protective Service, who are not police officers, or Niagara Parks officials, who are sort of a quasi, these are both sort of quasi police services. So they can also be investigated under the SIU Act. And believe it or not, their response rate to the invitation to participate in race-based data gathering was very, very low. And it served as a real problem to understanding what race has to do with the contention between the subject official, the accused officer, and the SIU. It's basically impossible for us to draw any inference, let alone anything that's statistically verifiable from the data that we've got. And this really does bring us to the issue of the verbiage in the legislation itself, that we're talking about these folks as service users. And I think that police have done a relatively good job of recognizing that their relationship to the quote service user is not the same that you would have with social services or with your child and family services or whatever else. It's not a service user relationship. There's no voluntariness to these organizations. This is a police or a law enforcement investigation that's going on. You can sort of understand, particularly through, I've been talking about Mark Crowell's PhD thesis a lot lately because I rediscovered it a couple weeks ago. He's the chief of Waterloo Regional Police. He conducted a very, very comprehensive survey. If I'm not mistaken, he interviewed or surveyed over 2,000 officers in Ontario and found that there is indeed a fairly contentious relationship, that attitudes among police officers towards the SIU are not especially high, that the SIU is viewed as being a bit of a civilian agency that doesn't necessarily appreciate police professionalism. So if that's the case, then you might understand why officers would be somewhat reluctant to participate in the survey. There's also the issue of data collection and how it's conducted, that you can imagine that some of these SIU reports, they've take quite a long time to come to, and maybe when they arrive, they're just put on the shelf and everybody's ready to move on at that point, and somebody misses that there's this self-addressed envelope in there saying, can you tell us a little bit about who you are? So that's been a major, major hamper to understanding what goes on here. So once we've got these groups, this is our disproportionality index, which everybody who's doing these types of analyses has to do, and this is where I had a ton of fun. Basically what this means is you have to find the population of whatever group it is in the province, and that's what we were doing with the census data, to try and find how many black folk live in Ontario, how many Asian and Southeast Asian folk live in Ontario, to create a benchmark population, and then we compare that to the program population. And you get a ratio that says, well, of all the people in the province, these people are disproportionately represented in your SIU data. Another major roadblock to this, and I think this is a bit of an oversight, is there is no benchmark information or no consistent benchmark information on what police officers look like in the province of Ontario. We do have a little bit of information from StatCan's survey on law enforcement services. We know, I don't remember the exact number nationally, it's somewhere between 4% and 8%, if I'm not mistaken, of officers self-report to being racialized or visible minorities. In York Region Police, I believe it's 19%, and in TPS, Toronto Police Service, it's about 24%. So We didn't have, the police services do report on this, but it's in a very inconsistent way. So we just kind of eyeballed it because we don't have any statistical data to compare it with. Anyways, we just assumed that Ontario Police Services would be about 15% on the whole representative of people who are visible minorities, but we don't know any of the breakdown for what those visible minorities are. So that's a real deficit, and it's something that we hope will be addressed in the future. Police services need to standardize that type of reporting. I'm surprised it hasn't happened yet because there is this impetus to have the police service reflect the racial and ethnic makeup of the populations that they serve. So once we get all that done, we put these things into a data table, and on the diagonal axis here, you'll have the disproportionality by population, so Indigenous folk versus Indigenous folk, and you'll see how they are. But then there's also a cross-comparative analysis, so we can say, well, you know, Indigenous folk are this much more overrepresented or this much more disproportionately represented than white folk, and white folk are this much more. To be honest with you, I don't know exactly what we'd want to do with those crosstabs. It makes sense in terms of seeing how different groups differently experience the disproportionality, but it just gives us the figures of who's most frequently either being injured or killed or sexually assaulted by the police. It doesn't tell us very much about the motive for participating in the survey itself. On top of this, the Act asks, and the data collection standards ask, that we do intersectional analyses and outcome-based analyses. Again, a real challenge for an institution where 97% of cases are decided along the same lines, and a lot of the service users in that 97%, or presumably about half the service users in that 97%, are not going to be very satisfied with that outcome. So that's been a real challenge to understand SIU processes, where the outcomes are coming from, because it is this process of investigators taking information and investigative evidence to the SIU director, and then that's all done quite quietly and in private. We do get a report about it afterwards, but there are definitely evaluative statements about what the director views to be credible or incredible evidence, and it's supported. I think there's anybody can sort of see what's going on, but there's still elements there that we'd like to know more about. I think another element that the order and council brings up here is that we cannot necessarily conclude that disproportionality is indicative of discrimination. And this is an issue that we flag, like this was written all over the walls to us as soon as we started this, and we had been warning the SIU about it continuously. This is the sewage treatment plant that's downriver from my house where everything in all Toronto's wastewater gets looked after. Fortunately, I am upwind of it, so it's mostly fine, but it'd say, you know, how do you blame the householder who lives next door to this for the smells coming from their kitchen? The metaphor is kind of similar for the SIU, that we know that racialized people are disproportionately affected by police violence, and we know that because Toronto Police was ahead of us. They actually had their race-based data out in advance, that race-based data that came from their use of force reports, and again, this is officer-collected data, and their strip search reports, and what they showed was that especially black people in Toronto were 2.2 times more likely to be involved in law enforcement interactions that resulted in injury. So it's of course intuitive to us then that if there are more likely to be use of force incidents involving black folk in the city of Toronto, there will be more injuries, more hospitalizations, more SIU investigations that go along with that. But of course the story doesn't end there. The question is, how does the SIU treat and interact with those folks? And really trying to figure out what that interaction is like is the core crux of what we wanted to accomplish in this project, and what we're hoping the SIU is going to come on board with us for in the next couple of months and start getting a bit more experiential data from folks who have been at the other end of police violence, those who have come through the investigative process, and have some comments about how the SIU functioned. So, what do we want to say about these data now that we've done the analysis? And the first thing that I want to bring up is that the data are profoundly voluntary, that there's no obligation for anybody to participate. And I think that really raises serious questions for us about the issue of, for example, volunteer bias. We want to know much more about the motive of individuals who are surrendering their data or handing their data over to the SIU and what it is that they're getting from this, what it is that they expect to come of it. The other issue that's going to come out of this is that because the disproportionality is already expected, we'd like to know where race becomes a factor. So we know that the numbers, and I'm sure that the numbers across Canada are going to look very similar, that the racial disproportionality numbers are going to look bad, because we know that this service is downstream of the police service that's disproportionately using violence against or using force against these types of populations. So it's worth taking a look at what their experience is like, how they were treated, what their impressions of the SIU were, that will add more information than the mere statistical frequency at which they're appearing or participating in the survey collection data. We also really, really want to know much more about the racial makeup of Toronto and, Ontario police officers, to understand exactly the ways that officers are being treated by the SIU on racialized terms. And I really think this is one of the things that's gone missing from the SIU's perspective. Is that officers are also affected by these investigations. These investigations are lengthy in a lot of cases. They span for 18 months, a year, 2 years. And it does hang over a police officer's life and their career. We were speaking about this earlier, that it has emotional and psychological impacts. It also can impact the police service more generally and the public. One of the things that we've seen spoken about with reference to specific incidents is that the longer an investigation goes on, the more the public seems inclined to draw conclusions about conspiracy and cover-up and a collusion between the SIU and the police service to produce an outcome that saves face for that police service. So really understanding more about officers' experience as kind of a forgotten group in this data, how it is that their races, how it is that they view their race as being instrumental or a factor within these investigations. Are they experiencing different types of treatments or the perception of different types of treatments because of their race? So we have engaged in some qualitative interviewing with officers. It's been a slow-going slog. Participation rates are low across the board, but the few that we've had participate have been enthusiastic participants, and they do tell us some very interesting things about the effects of that process on them. We have yet to have any racialized officers volunteer to participate, and I'm very keen to see what goes on in that data. I think we've all seen some of the discourse around the Memphis incident again, and how race is mobilized in these types of discussions and speculated about and so forth. We also do interview affected persons, and again, data collection is a slog. I really underestimated the willingness of affected persons to participate in this type of participation, this type of study. I thought participation would have been very enthusiastic. There would have been an opportunity to get your story on the record, as it were, but it turns out that maybe a white sociologist working in a criminology department doesn't inspire a whole ton of confidence in the racialized people who would be sort of our target market, as it were, our target population for this type of study. So, having done the analysis and sitting in a room of people who are familiar with policing and criminology, I think what I would say is that there's very little that surprised me in these data. The disproportionalities that were represented in the data are pretty much exactly what I expected in starting, and I think any one of us would probably draw very similar conclusions. Really, the thing that I think that we need to do with this type of information is get beyond the statistics and start probing at that issue of participation. There are some things that are going to be released in the report that I think show interesting, and this is strictly the statistical information, that show interesting incentives to participate. And I think it's really worth exploring those, and I'll be happy to share the report as soon as it is kosher to do so with anybody who's interested. We do have a website up for the project. It's actually on the slides here, seeingjustice.ca, if you're interested, and we'll be posting that the very second we can get it up there. It'll be in our blog section. It's not an especially sophisticated looking website, but you hopefully find it. But do feel free to email me and I'll be happy to share them along. There are some things that I think come out in there and some additional data analyses that we've done that show some challenges that the SIU needs to overcome in addressing people in that affected person category and earning their trust so that they're willing to converse with the SIU. I really am working hard on lobbying the Ontario provincial government right now to allow for this secondary data analysis or this indirect data analysis. I really think it's a much better form of data for the intent of the act. I think it's much more important to know the impression of what the of who the investigator believes they're interacting with, rather than the self-report of the individual. I think part of that is that we're sort of taking it on good faith, and I have no reason to believe otherwise, but that people are reporting what they believe they're perceived as. I think, you know, we've all seen the challenges of identity and claiming identity in different statuses that are maybe not perceived by others as being the status that's claimed. So if it's not a perceived racial category, then what good are these data for us for determining the type of influence that race would have on the investigator and the director's outcomes on these things? So I'm really pushing hard to get in front of the Attorney General of Ontario to change the data collection technique and go to this indirect form that I think will tell us much more about any sorts of threats or perceptions of implicit bias or explicit bias, for that matter, within the organization itself. And I think sort of more generally, the thing that a lot of us who are working in this area of civilian police oversight are doing is we're trying to beat the drum on citizen engagement and improving the citizenry's knowledge of how policing and police oversight in particular works. That when you have a complaint about your conduct, the police conduct, knowing which institutions to go to. And I'm really hoping that through understanding more of the experience of these people who have been through the investigative process, we'll get better purchase on how to facilitate that type of knowledge to the public to say, these are the mechanisms that you need to activate. These are the ways to mobilize your agency and your democratic rights, quite frankly, when it comes to consenting to the type of police service that you have in a democratic society. So, I actually have not kept track of time at all, and I don't know if I've run over or if that's short, but we're good, okay, all right. But again, thank you very much for the opportunity to come and sort of speak preliminarily at least, and maybe when the report's out, I can send everybody an update and we'll chat more on Zoom or whatever, because I think there are some interesting things to be said about what's gone on.
Thank you very much.